Hi there, it's Marlene Hillema from ImageMaven.com. If you've got a Lumix camera, you might have noticed a setting buried in the menus called Eye.Resolution. In this video, I'm going to tell you what that's all about. Welcome back, subscribers, and if this is your first time here, well, I teach photography, photo editing, a bit of lighting, and I'm a huge fan of Lumix cameras. Please subscribe so you don't miss any of my future videos. A couple weeks ago, I made a video about the Eye.Dynamic setting in Lumix cameras, and someone left me a comment. He wanted to know about this setting, the Eye.Resolution. By the way, if you missed that Eye.Dynamic video, you can watch it now. There's a link right there. Now, the explanation of Eye.Resolution in the Lumix owner's manual is a bit thin, but basically, it's all about sharpening. Now, there's other ways to sharpen your images. You can actually go into the photo styles of your Lumix cameras and you can choose sharpening right in there. That's one way to do it. You can sharpen in post-production. So you can sharpen in Photoshop. Say after you resize your image for the final use, you can sharpen it. That's actually a highly recommended method as well. Another way you can do it is if you use Lightroom, you can sharpen on export. So every image you export has the same amount of sharpening and you can sharpen for paper printing or for web use and that sort of thing. And if you have a Lumix camera, you can sharpen using Eye.Resolution. Now, sharpening is a misnomer of sorts. To actually sharpen an image, you're going to need to bring it more in focus using your lens. But when we sharpen after the fact or internally in the camera, all we're actually doing is increasing the contrast between the edges of your image. So if you have a highly detailed image, it has a lot of edges and it will sharpen the contrast between those edges. So why use the term resolution in Eye.Resolution, even though we're talking about sharpening? Well, when an image is sharper, it actually appears that it could have been taken with a higher megapixel camera. So the resolution of that file is larger and it appears sharper when that's the case. I know it's kind of confusing, but just keep this in mind. Eye resolution equals sharpening. To set up Eye.Resolution, go into page 2 of the camera setup menu and you'll find it right under Eye.Dynamic. Now in Lumix cameras, you can set up eye resolution as high, standard, low, or off. In other Lumix cameras, there's an extended setting as well. Eye resolution doesn't work in intelligent auto mode, but it works in all the other modes, including video, and it even works with the creative filters, which are built into Lumix cameras, and that's a bonus because those are very hard to recreate, if not impossible, if you shoot raw files. And don't forget, by the way, if you do shoot RAW files and you're using those creative filters, make sure you have RAW plus JPEG set up or you'll be sorely disappointed. Now let's look at some images close up. Now I'm going to say up front that because you're watching this on YouTube and YouTube applies a certain amount of compression to make those videos play well online, you might not notice a huge difference. So as always, I say to test for yourself to be sure. But let's have a look anyway. Okay, the first image we're looking at is two shots of this blue truck. The one on the left is the high setting on eye resolution and the one on the right is off. And even right away, you can hopefully tell in some areas that it is quite a bit crisper. You can see on the railing here of the stairwell that the one on the left is sharper than the one on the right. And let's look at this black and white text here. Definitely made a difference. Now you wouldn't pick up any noise artifacts really because this building is quite old and distressed, but honestly the noise artifacts are so minimal I don't even think you can call it that. You get more noise artifacts from raising your ISO. Okay, another image here. In this area here, you can see this sort of like broken piece of wood, and it's definitely sharper on the one on the left, which again is high compared to off. Just these wires and detailed areas. Let's go back to some more text. The one on the left, definitely sharper. And the one on the left again is noticeably sharper, at least to me. I'm hoping you can see some of this difference. like I said, you're going to have to test this for yourself. Okay, next, in this image we have tons of fine detail. We've got grids and we've got branches and lots of rust, so there's so much detail. This is the kind of image where it really helps to make the detail really crispy and makes it pop. And definitely see it in this area with these metal grids and things. I can see it in the antennas at the top myself, especially on the diagonals. And the edge of the building as well. Okay, this image has really shallow depth of field. And you can definitely see it in these seed pods. Much crisper. The image on the left is again set at high. The image on the right is off. You can definitely see the crispness on the edges where the bokeh is. Next image, again a little bit shallower depth of field on this one, and bright colors, which tend to really make, you know, the sharpness even more accentuated and easier to see. Just adds a little crispiness to your shots. Hopefully you can see it with this image. If you look at areas of text, you often see that it shows up a bit more. I can see it in the spring here. And there's the background, the difference in the background. It actually sharpens up the bokeh just slightly, maybe something you don't want to happen. And that's it. Now in my images, I did notice some artifacts in some areas. Now, I'm not talking huge artifacts. I mean, less artifacts than having high noise in your images. But I did notice them, if I'm honest. But you know, they're not really bothersome. I also noticed some haloing in things like, say there was like a twig sticking up. I had some haloing against the edge of the twig, against the background, if the background was softer. And a little bit of haloing between colors that are very contrasty, like black versus white. I noticed some haloing, but again, very slight, okay, very small. When should you use eye dot resolution? And I say when you want to sizzle up an image that has a lot of detail. Architecture, street photography, sports photography, perhaps macro work. And when shouldn't you use it? Well, please don't use it for portraits, at least not for portraits of me or other women of a certain age. If you want to sharpen portraits, I suggest you do that manually in post-processing. Perhaps you want to, you know, sharpen the eyes or eyelashes of a portrait, but it's really not recommended to sharpen skin unless you're looking for that really crispy, you know, high contrast look. And most portraits, you wouldn't do that with. Also, if you shoot with a super soft bokeh effect, like the super soft background, you might want to be cautious with sharpening that background. You don't want to sharpen your bokeh when you've spent so much time and money on lenses to get the good bokeh. You don't want to sharpen it back in. So keep in mind, that has to do more with focus and not with sharpening. There's a little bit of a difference there in terminology. Focus has to do with optics, lens optics, and sharpening has to do with the image and the pixels and the changing contrast. Okay, so that's the difference there. So as usual, I'm going to recommend test it. If you've been watching my videos for a while, you know that I always say everybody's tastes are different. You might like a certain amount of sharpening, and I might not like it, or vice versa. Everybody's different, so test it for yourself. Every camera might produce a different result as well. So that's what you want to do, test it. And test it on different types of images as well. Do I like it? Yes, I do. I surprised myself. I went into this tutorial thinking, man, I'll never use iDot resolution. Like, who needs it? I can sharpen in post and, you know, I'm never going to capture images with that. But you know what? I actually like it. I think I'm going to use like the standard and just leave it on with certain types of images. Not for portraits, of course, as I mentioned, but for any other types of images that I like to shoot, I think it works well and adds just the right amount of sharpening to my JPEGs. So like I said, test it for yourself to see if it's for you. Thanks for watching. It's Marlene Hielema from ImageMaven.com. If you like this video, give me a thumbs up and let me know if you have any questions in the comments below.